One, two.
Okay, you can hear me? Can you hear me over there? Over there? What about the video? I think we're supposed to record this. Is there someone hiding there? Is there someone there? No. Okay, I'm hoping someone is recording. Okay, welcome to CS446. I see that it's pretty crowded, so my goal today is actually to tell you a little bit about the class. Hopefully not all of you will take the class. Just that there isn't enough room here. So let's start with a little bit logistics. We're going to go to learning and then move back to logistics toward the end. If you're stuck back there, you can move to the other side. There's more standing room. Or you can just go in. There's a lot of room on the staircase on this side. Okay, so this is machine learning. We're going to meet here Tuesday, Thursday, 12:30. I think you know this. We are going to have 40 A's that I think are here. Kaiway here. Brian is there. Chense somewhere there. And Rongda over there. Okay. Just kind of the gist of what you're going to do in the class. You're going to learn about machine learning. There's going to be quite a few and quite demanding, I think, problem sets, probably seven, maybe plus or minus one, and several of them are going to be programming intensive. There's going to be class exercises. We'll see how many we can handle with this big of a class. And definitely there's going to be also discussion sections. So I'm going to add 1 hour in the afternoons. I'm going to talk about it at the end for discussion sections that the TAs will give. There's going to be a midterm exam. There's going to be a project for people that take it for 4 hours, which I think is almost a half of you, at least according to what's listed now. And there's going to be a final exam. So there are really no textbooks. Those of you, hopefully all of you that have looked at the website, saw that there's a list of recommended books. I'm not going to really follow the books. There's going to be lecture notes that I'll post every lecture. The final version is going to be available only after the lecture. There are going to be some preliminary versions, some approximations before the lecture. And I'm going to also point you to the literature in some cases. Okay, one important issue that I know a lot of you are concerned about, registration. Currently, the registration is full. My expectation, again, I put a note on the website, and hopefully many of you looked at it. My expectation is that a percentage of you will drop the class in the first week or two. So there's going to be more room. This is what has happened in the last few years. So statistically, this is what we're doing here. It's pretty safe bet. One request I have, I'm going to talk about details and logistics of the registration a little bit later toward the end, but one request I have, if you know that you're going to drop the class, do it as soon as you can, because some people are really kind of stressed out about not having a place, and it affects my inbox. So here's the reason. Okay, so as I said, I'm going to go back to logistics toward the end, but I want to talk about what is the course about. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what's learning, what is the class about, but I want to actually, and I'm going to give you a puzzle. In fact, I'm going to give you the puzzle now. So it's going to take a few minutes to spread this around. So I don't know. You can move it in the middle section. This will be this section. and this will be the other one. Two requests. Don't say anything if you know how to solve the puzzle, because I want to leave it, I want to leave the solutions for later, probably next time. Don't think too hard, because you have to also listen to me, but I think you can do at least two things at the same time. I see some of you are doing Facebook, so I'm sure you can concentrate on these two. So just look at it. I'm going to talk about it a little bit later. Don't say anything if you know how to solve it. Okay. I want to answer to this question. So let's see. How many are computer science graduate students? How many are ECE graduate students? How many are graduate students not in CS or ECE? Where? Say something. Where are you, student? You raised your hand. Other options? No, graduate students not in CS or ECE. Math? Civil? Other things? Okay. Undergraduates in CS? Okay, not as many as I thought. Undergraduates in other places? Where? Math. Not other than ECE and math? Statistics. Other options? Physics. Okay, did I cover everything, or there are some other things that... Okay, that's good. So I'm going to get to it a little bit when I talk about logistics, but just the population is actually about what I've seen before, only that it's about doubled what I've seen before across the board. And the key reason I want to know this is, I know that some of the undergrads are, they want to take the class, they're a little bit worried that it's going to be too hard, and I think it sometimes is hard for undergrads, although sometimes the top students in the class are undergrads. So given that there's a relatively large population of undergrads, we'll see if this stays this way, it's likely that the grading curves are going to be somewhat different for grads and undergrads, but you know, we'll see as we go. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about learning, and what is learning and what is this class about. And the first thing I'm going to show you here is a slide with a poem. You can read it. And I see that some of you are smiling. Why are you smiling? But
as written text,
it has a couple of spelling mistakes. Right? And you can recognize it, but try to run this through your favorite spell checker. Will not get it. Why won't it get it? Probably because most of the tokens are actually legitimate tokens. They're only wrong in the context. And you got it very easily. So think about writing a program that will do this. In fact, I would argue you cannot write a conventional program, whatever that means, that can correct this. The way you do it is you've read a lot of text and you understand context. You know what tokens are appropriate in what context somehow, and you can figure it out. And that's kind of the thing that we want to do with machine learning, right? If you want to write a program that can correct this, and it's very difficult to do in today's technology even, the only chance you have is if you can do some machine learning. So this is an extreme example, actually one of my favorite examples. And maybe we won't get there, but in general, the reason there are so many people in this class now is really machine learning is everywhere. You can think about so many examples today that whether you know it or not, the underlying technology is some sort of machine learning. Here's a picture. We can ask a lot of machine learning questions about it. For example, what's this question? Again? So I heard two different answers. Both of them are correct. So one, some people said face detection. I just want to know whether there are faces there. Where are the faces? I want to localize the faces. This is rather easy here because, you know, the other things maybe are not good candidates, but you can imagine places where this in itself is very difficult. And the second thing I heard is face recognition. Right, I want to know who these people are. You know who these people are. Probably 100% or close to 100% accuracy. Can we do this? You can ask other machine learning driven questions about this. What else can you ask? Are they happy? Are they sad? You know, what's the mood? And so on. Here is an email message, and you can see at the top there that I highlighted that mail thinks this message is a junk mail. Again, a machine learning decision, a classifier that decided, I don't know why, that this email is a spam. Translation. Many of you are using it. You know, given a sentence, you want to translate it to a different language. Machine learning driven. Recommendation system. You go buy a book or anything else. Amazon decides that you probably want other things and they think that they know what you want. Machine learning driven. Ads. You Google for something, the first thing you see more often that you want, and sometimes it fits and sometimes it doesn't. It's an output of a machine learning classifier that decides which ads to place next to your search or your search results. And you know that sometimes it's okay, and more often than not, it's not okay. But these are all outputs of machine learning models. In most cases, classification models, which is kind of the basic, the fundamental approach to machine learning. So let's think a little bit about one of these, spam detection. What is really happening here? So you have this email, and really it's a binary classification task, right? So we want to develop something that knows how to assign one of two labels. Either it's yes, it's a spam, no, it's not a spam, to this input. And in this case it says, yes, I think it's spam. Really, in order to do this, you need some kind of a model, which we're going to call a classifier, which determines which label to assign to these items. And this is actually what we're going to study in this class. We're going to look at algorithms, techniques to develop these kind of models, as well as the theory underlying these kind of models. But there are more interesting problems than this. So here is a range of problems that you can think about, for example, if you deal with text. The first one is actually an instance of what I've shown you before. Could I have a piece of cake? Hopefully you realize that this piece is misspelled. It should be the P-I-E-C-E kind of. But again, both of them are legitimate words. You have to be able to develop some model, a classifier, that given the sentence determine whether this is the right kind of piece, yes or no. Again, a binary classifier, the way I present it here. The next example is what is called word sense disambiguation. The word plant is being used in two different senses, right? You can see that the plant at the top one is a different word than the plant in the bottom one. They're just spelled exactly the same. You know it. Can you write a program that will figure it out? The third example is even more interesting. Buy a car with a steering wheel, or buy a car with his money. You can see that the word with here actually could be interpreted in two different ways. Either you buy with money, or there's a car with a steering wheel. So depending on the sentence, the with actually has a different interpretation. Agreed? And again, the question is, how do you know? How do you know in this case what is the with referring to, whether it's car with or buy with? Context, and moreover, it's not only the context, you have to know something. You have to know something about the world. You have to have some background knowledge, because I could replace steering wheel here with what?
Fire.
And I could replace money with check, coupons. And you know, it's the same for you, right? You want it to be the same also to your, for your model. And the fact that you can easily answer these questions means that, you know, it's a trivial question. It's a trivial question, but it's a very difficult question if you want to write a program to do this. The next one is a part of speech tagging problem. So given a sentence, I want to figure out what are the verbs, what are the nouns, what are the adjectives, and so on. This is maybe not a problem that someone would care about when they, you know, shop for something or other things, but it's a fundamental question that a lot of the text-based classifiers need to know. And you can see that here, a lot of things are ambiguous. Almost all these words, can, will, and rust. Can be a noun. In this case, it's a noun, but the most common part of speech tag of can is not a noun. Will can be a modal verb, could be other things, could be a noun. Same for us. And here you want to be able to not only classify each word, but you really want it to make sense over the sentence, right? So it's unlikely that this will be a noun and this will also be a noun, right? So if you make a decision with respect to one word in the sentence, it should impact the decisions you make on others. So it's perhaps slightly more complicated, at least at the level of task definition, than a classification, a binary classification like spam. And again, this is a decision, finally, where we look at two sentences. So the dog bit the kid, he was taken to a vet. Or an alternative, the dog bit the kid, he was taken to a hospital. Your understanding of what he means here is different depending on how I end the sentence. Again, so here you have multiple sentences and you have to somehow think about them together in order to make a decision. These are all machine learning driven decisions. The underlying models are going to be different, but the fundamentals are identical in all these problems. What we want is we want to be able to learn a function that maps observation in the domain, examples that we're going to see, and we're going to formalize this as we go, to one of several categories. So in this case, perhaps the two categories are just PCEA or PCIE. In this case, perhaps two categories, linked with the verb or linked with the noun. In this case, maybe it's 45 categories, different part of speech that we think that exist in English, or at least one formulation thinks that exist in English. But you can also think about, maybe what I want to do is I want to map the whole sentence to a sequence of categories, right? So now I have a huge number of categories, right? Because if for each one word I have 45 options and my sentence is of size 10, the number of output sequences is five to the 10, large number. So maybe I don't want to model it this way, but at least on the face of it, this is one way to model it. But in all cases, this is what we're after, right? We want to learn a function from data, and this function is going to be a mapping from input to the output that we define. Here's another example that is a little bit more interesting. This is a story, story comprehension of the type that all of you have seen when you did, you know, any of the standardized tests. This is actually taken, is taken from a story comprehension of third graders. So it's very easy. Here are some questions. In fact, I restated the questions as statements. So I want to know whether the statements are true in the context of this story. And really, I want to be able to answer these questions or determine the truth value of these statements. But this is a much, much harder question than just a machine learning question. But underlying this, there are a lot of machine learning questions that I have to solve, or machine learning driven questions that I have to solve. For example, I have these three names here: Christopher Robin, Chris, Mr. Robin. Is this the same person? Who says yes? Raise your hand. Who says no? Okay, read it again. Who says yes now? Who says no now? Don't be shy, you should vote. It's important to vote. Let's try again. Who says yes? Who says no? Okay, I think by majority, no wins. Why is it no? One is the father of the other. But it takes time, and you have to know things about language. You also have to know things about the world. You have to know that if A is the father of B, A and B are not the same person. Easy, but your classifier needs to know this. And there's a lot of other decisions in this story that are of that type, that you have to solve as classification problems. There's a lot of pronouns, there's a lot of relations here, and so on. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but really you can think about it as an inference problem, right? So you got the story, you got the question, and you have to think about it and make decisions. So where is learning here? Where's the learning? Did someone tell you something here? You learned it. So you brought your knowledge from home. You've acquired it over a long time. So you did learn something. And in the context of this story, you're making decisions using your learned knowledge somehow, which is really our goal, right? Our goal is not only to do learning. Our goal is to figure out how can learning support more interesting decisions. And this would be an example of it. But you can already see that learning is not necessarily something that you do, you know, when you make the decisions. It's probably something you've done in the past. Here is another possibly very different examples. What do you see here? For example, what do you see? Okay, over there, someone from that side. I'm standing here. It doesn't mean that you can't talk to me. What do you see? Okay, excellent. So notice that the way we got you, all of you almost, gave the answers is you did not name specific objects. You said animals. There are multiple animals here. But you actually did some abstraction. You categorized them already because it's easier for you to do it this way. You didn't say, well, some did say, you know, green pepper, but some said vegetables. So you did some categorization. Notice also that if you look at some of the shoes and some of the cars, look at them carefully. You'll see that a lot of the cars are more similar to shoes than they are to other cars. If you just look at it at the pixel level. And that happens for other things. So the size is completely wrong, colors might be wrong, doesn't bother you at all. You can recognize these objects. So what is the problem here? What's the machine learning problem? One perspective would be categorization. You know, I want to collect items that are similar based on something. and most of you have chosen functionally, right? You didn't cluster it by size, because it's meaningless here, or world size even. You chose to categorize it by functionality. So it's some kind of a clustering problem. And again, you can think about it multiple ways. You can think about it as a learning problem similar to those that we had before, where you're being trained to identify specific objects. But the interesting thing was, in this experiment that we just did, is that almost none of you chose to identify specific objects, but rather to give me names of clusters. So not only you did clustering of this object, but you also named them. Very difficult task, actually. In fact, we don't know how to do it well. Okay, so these are examples, and I'm kind of done with examples because I think we covered a lot of the things that are interesting here. So really, learning is at the core of all these things. You can think about learning as something that is at the core of high-level cognition. All the examples I've given here, except for the first slide, were really cognitive science kind of tasks. Performing what I call knowledge-intensive inference, you know, like understanding a story. In general, developing adaptive or intelligent systems like spam detection system or recommendation system or so on. In general, we need to do it because the world we're facing is really providing us with messy data. I mean, you really never see the same image twice, if you think about it. You never hear the same audio signal exactly the same, but it doesn't bother you, right? So you can deal with this, you can abstract over this very easily. And that's what we'll be able to do, we want to be able to do. So learning has a lot of purposes, and I'm mentioning here a few. Knowledge acquisition, we've seen it in all the examples, that some of the issues that we wanted learning to achieve for us was to acquire some knowledge and tell us the context in which PCA appears versus PCIE appears. We want to be able to integrate a lot of knowledge, a lot of signals from multiple sources in order to ensure robust behavior. So when you do spam filtering, what information are you using? You might be using a lot of information. Who sends the data? What's in the data? What time was it sent to? How many other people got the same thing? A lot of signals that could allow you perhaps to determine that this is spam. And in general, adaptation, you know, both of humans and of systems. So that's what we want to do. And you can think about a definition for what is learning. Someone dares to define what is learning? Okay, you don't have to. It's not an easy thing to do. Herbert Simon, who is a famous AI and economics researcher, defined quite a few years ago learning as learning denotes changes in the system that are adaptive in the sense that they enable the system to do the task or tasks drawn from the same population more efficiently and more effectively the next time, which is a sensible definition. I want to focus on one thing that he said here, drawn from the same population. You will see that this is crucial to any formalization effort that we want to do. We as computer scientists, we need to formalize this so we can study this mathematically and figure out what we're doing and whether what we're doing makes sense. And you will see, it will take a couple of weeks, that this is really essential to any definition to make sense and to allow us to develop a theory. But I actually want to focus not so much on the adaptation, but I want to focus on generalization. So the ability to perform a task in situations that we've never seen before, to me, this is the core of learning. And how can we do this? How can we behave in new situations? And as I said, in many respects, all situations are new, if you think about it. Nevertheless, it doesn't bother you. You can understand what I'm saying, even though you've never heard this before. not a problem. So really, I want to equate learning with generalization. So think about this email thing, right? So what you want is a function that maps email messages to spam, but it's very unlikely, even in this relatively small domain, we can debate that, that you've seen this message before, right? So how would you be able to tell that this message is spam? Some keywords in the message. Who sent it? The? Do you expect what? Okay. Domain names. What do you mean by crowdsourcing? Okay, I wouldn't call it crowdsourcing, but just the fact that it was sent to many, many people could be an indication if you're able to know this. Right, so this is something you've seen before. but basically, all these are some characteristics of this. I mean, they could be characteristics of many other things. So basically, rather than looking at this, you are extracting features. This is the terminology that we're going to use from this, and you hope that some combination of these features eventually is going to be characteristics of spam or allow you to distinguish between spam and not spam. So mail in this case thinks this is junk email, and really the learner that we're going to develop has to be able to classify items it has never seen before, and that's the key. And you made some suggestions on, you know, what kind of issues might be important to this learner to notice. But you know, the same thing is going to happen in any problem that you're looking at it. I mean, any classification problem. Think about medical diagnosis, credit card applications, or credit card use, handwritten letters. It's also important in many other scenarios that have learning, you know, underlying them, from planning and acting in an environment to learning skills or to common sense reasoning. So all these, really the bottom line is what you care about is, can I generalize to new, previously unseen situations? So that's what we have to think about. So I'm putting again this sentence, the ability to perform a task in a situation which has never been encountered before. This is key. Now, technically, what will allow us to do it? So a lot of people think about algorithms. How can we develop algorithms that will do it? But one thing that is a big secret, and you will learn in this class, is that really, even though we're going to talk a lot about algorithms, in fact, the class is about learning algorithms, generalization really depends on representation as much, if not more, than on the algorithm being used. And by representation, we can mean many things. One of the things we mean are all these ideas that you gave for features. The function should have some variables it depends on, and you've given several ideas for what these variables might be. This is the responsibility of you as an algorithm developer or as a machine learning box developer to figure out what are the features that I'm going to extract as a way to even have a chance to develop an algorithm that does something that I want it to do. So these two issues of representation and algorithms are going to be really the underlying issues. Unfortunately, we're not going to talk a lot about representation. We're going to talk about it some, and the key reason is that we don't know a lot about it. We really don't have a good theory for, okay, so what are the features I should extract, and what are the representations I should use? Hopefully, with you as the next generation of researchers, we'll know more and more about this, but really this is something we don't know a lot. So why do we study learning? Well, I don't think I can need to argue it anymore with 200 plus students in the class, so we can skip that. There are many, many reasons to study learning. And really, the bottom line is that the time is right. I mean, we really have initial algorithms. In fact, I would say we have pretty good understanding of some key problems in learning, like classification. Understanding both of theory and algorithmic understanding. We have a lot of data. We have a lot of computational power, so we can do things that people in the 60s that actually knew a lot of the algorithms we're going to study in this class. This is another surprise. A lot of the algorithms, as you'll see, you know, people kind of knew them many years ago. They didn't do anything then. Now we can use them. The time is right, basically, to do it. And also, it's necessity. You know, a lot of the things that we want to do, we just cannot do by conventional programming. So I think all the examples that I've given at the beginning, you know, starting from the context-sensitive spelling to the language comprehension to the computer vision and to the kind of simpler problems of ads, spam, recommendation system, we just cannot program conventionally. And again, if you think about it, I think you'll convince yourself that that's the case. Okay, so learning is the future. There's a lot of stuff we can do, and I believe that any non-trivial computer program that interacts with the real world eventually will have machine learning components. Nevertheless, there's a lot of open issues. So I assume that the reason you're here, or the reasons you're here, are quite diverse. I mean, some people just know that it's hot and want to know what it is about, and some people have some ideas of, you know, what they want to do, and some people perhaps want to do research in this area. There's room for all of you, because I think there's a lot of unresolved issues, both from the perspective of theory and algorithmic issues, and from the perspective of system development. How to develop programs, systems, that have at their core machine learning ideas. And that brings me actually to a shameless plug that I'm looking for my group, for someone that has interest both in machine learning and programming languages, for a project that has to do with a programming language for machine learning. It's not so easy to find people with these two interests, so if you are someone like that, or you know of someone, please let me know, send me email. Okay, so machine learning is an area that is quite diverse in terms of the technical requirements. It builds on probability and statistics, linear algebra, statistics again, theory of computation, a few other things, and it's related to a lot of other areas and application to other areas. And a lot of engineering departments and science departments, in fact, everywhere today, people are using machine learning techniques one way or another. From your perspective, as people that take the class, you should mostly read this sentence at the top, because these are the type of prerequisites or knowledge that I hope you have, and we'll get to it. So the bottom line, it's a very, very active field. You know, hundreds of papers are being written every year, if not more today. This raises an important issue of what to teach in the class. A lot of the stuff that is being written, just like any active scientific area, a lot of it is unimportant and not going to stay. So I'm going to try to teach the fundamental paradigms of machine learning that I think you should understand, because this is going to stay, and everything else is going to be able, you'll be able to fold into these paradigms. I'm going to try to teach some of the most important algorithmic ideas, and again, as I said, there's a lot of them, and hopefully what we're going to study this semester are those ideas that either have stayed or will stay and are important for you to understand. And we're going to try to talk a little bit about modeling. The difficulty with modeling is that there's very little theory behind it, but it's extremely important. How to look at a problem and say, okay, this is how I'm going to model it, and this is what I'm going to do. Very difficult. And in fact, this is not necessarily the right class for it, because I'm teaching introduction and basic principles and theory. We may need a different class that focuses on modeling, but we're going to try to give some ideas. And of course, I'm going to try to talk a little bit about what we don't know and how this could, you know, impact what you want to do if you want to continue in this area. Okay, so a little bit more in more details about this class. So by the way, I'm glad that you're not carefully looking at this badges thing, but anyone looked at it already and knows the solution? Okay, good. Keep it secret. Anyhow, so what is the class about? Don't go back to it now. We'll get to it. I just wanted to get an idea of what's happening. So this is essentially an outline. We're going to start with introduction. I'm doing it today. I'm going to continue next time with a detailed example. And throughout the class, we're going to cover two basic paradigms. One of them is called PAC, for probably approximately correct, sometimes called risk minimization, sometimes called discriminative learning. But really, the theoretical paradigm underlying it is that of PAC. And I'm going to talk about Bayesian theory of probabilistic learning. We're going to talk about multiple learning protocols, basically what type of interactions we assume when we study learning algorithms. The key one is supervised learning, where the learner, your program, is exposed to examples along with their labels. And from that, we're trying to learn a function that will behave okay in the future. But we'll also talk about unsupervised learning a little bit, semi-supervised, which is an in-between protocol. We're going to cover several algorithms or family or algorithmic families, starting with decision trees. I have a line here, there for rules, but even though I think it's important, I'm not going to cover it this time because we just don't have time. We're going to talk a lot about linear threshold units because it's really the workhorse of machine learning today. Almost all the algorithms are linear threshold units in one form or another. We're probably going to talk about neural networks because it's hot again. I used to teach it maybe 10 years ago, and then we stopped teaching it, and it's in the news, so we have to teach it. Nothing has changed. It's just in the news. So, and we'll talk about probabilistic representations and learning with latent variables a little bit. The last bullet of clustering dimensionality reduction, I doubt that we'll get there, but you know, maybe we'll talk about it in one last lecture. I have two questions here. So who has learned decision trees already? Okay, not that many. Who's learned neural networks already? Okay. Of the people that learn neural networks, have you programmed backpropagation? Who has done that? Okay, so I just wanted to know what's... let's go back to logistics. Questions so far? Anyone has... It's, as you'll see in a second, it's online. So all the data, everything that I gave you is also online. I was actually deliberate thinking whether I should print it or not, but I think it's a little bit easier to see this way. Okay, so one thing you've noticed so far is that I really would like to hear from you when I teach and interact with you when I teach, even though there are quite a few people, but I think it's useful both for you and for me. So the truth is, I'm sure many other people told you, if you have a question or a comment, at least half the other students around you have a similar question or comment. So just ask. It's going to be useful for everyone. And it's very useful for me because especially when we teach something, I really want to know what do you get from it. And sometimes, you know, there's one misunderstanding that will help me to kind of twist it or explain it a little bit differently. So interaction is important. So I'm going to try to get it from you, and I'm hoping that you'll help me. Details. So I've shown this this slide already. I want to make one note on the books. So there's a lot of machine learning books. I don't think there is any good textbook for machine learning today. I used to mention Mitchell as the class book, and all the others recommended. I changed it now. All of them are recommended. So there's a 6-7 books there. Don't buy them. Not because they are not good. I think they are all good books. They are very expensive. So, no, really too expensive, I think. So, eventually, if you're going to do research in this area or work in this area, you'll buy them. But for the class itself, I reserved copies in the library, and this should be sufficient. I mean, don't invest $500 in books just for the class. All the information that we have is going to be in the lecture notes. As I said, look at the website, follow it up. There are already lecture notes there from the previous time I taught it. All of them are going to change one way or another, but it's going to give you a pretty good baseline. You can, you know, do whatever you want, print it and write notes or do something else, but after the class, I'm going to put, or within an hour or 2 hours after the class, I'm going to put the version that I'm using in the class. I mean, sometimes I'll put it before, but I don't want to commit that I'll put it before because I often change it a little bit, given comments or questions from you. So everything is going to be available online. That's an important comment. Okay, registration. So I know that this is an important issue. So as I said, my assumption is, and it's backed up by statistics from the last few years, is that a percentage, you know, could be 10%, could be, you know, a little bit more, of you will drop the class in the first couple of weeks. So there's going to be enough room for the people that are interested and couldn't register. Now, starting at 2 o'clock, I'm going to develop a list of people that want to be in the class. So this is what I want you to do. Not now. Send me email after class. Please use the following title. It's going to be much easier for me to deal with it. CS446 this way, last name, comma, first name, comma, registration. So I'll know what it is about. And if you want to say something, put it in the body of the email. I'm going to collect the list of people, and within the next 2 weeks, I think, my assumption is that all of you will be able to register. Now, for graduate students, it's not a big problem because you can register to the class, I don't know, until the middle of the semester. For undergrads, it's a little bit more of a problem because you don't have such a big margin. But so tell me whether you're an undergrad or a grad. And as I said before, if you know that you'll drop the class, do it quickly. You know, it's just no point in waiting. Questions on that? Yeah. Or taking the class. Okay, so good question. So I'd like to think that the class adds something. So my experience has been that people enjoy the class and gain something from it because it's better to talk about things and listen to classes than just to look at it without any interaction. I hope that I'm right. Again, statistically, I'm right. Now, there is one big difference between taking the class and auditing the class. Again, if you want to audit the class, I already got a couple of requests. It's possible. you're going to lose a lot by not taking the class, because I think that the problem sets, even though some of them will not be trivial for you, I can guarantee that, are very, very important. So the goal of me and with the help of the TAs is actually to teach you something from the problem in the problem sets. So it's not going to be just, you know, we said this in slide 17, what did we say? What did we mean or something? It's going to be demanding, you're going to learn something from every problem set. And the reason I want to do it this way is because I think that this is the right way, and there's a lot of stuff I want you to learn, and not everything can be covered in class. So you will learn from doing the 7 ± 1 problem sets. Okay, so I'm assuming that you know something, you know, that you've taken probability statistics, something like that, you've taken linear algebra, you've taken some kind of theory of computation, or at least you have some algorithmic maturity. So if I say NP complete, at least you know what it is. I typically not going to ask you to prove, but you know something about it, that you can program, with one exception, which is the first problem set, where we actually are going to do it in MATLAB, and we're going to give you templates. So if you've never seen MATLAB, I don't think it's going to be a big problem, because we're really going to give you templates. Other than that, the programming is in any language you want, but you need to be able to program. Homework zero is already on the web. The idea of homework zero is to give you an idea of what I think you should know. Now, I don't mean, and in fact, I don't think it's the case for the vast majority of you, that you can take homework zero and without thinking just kind of write a solution. I think some of the problems there might be easy for you, and some might require you to kind of think and maybe even go back to the books. But I'm hoping that the vocabulary in all the problems is you're familiar with it, you've seen some of this stuff, and if it's not kind of at the top of your head, the role of homework zero is to make sure now it is at the top of your head. So you can refresh your what you've done before, and you know what we're asking for. So please look at it. We're not going to grade homework zero, but we're going to talk about it in the next session, the TA sessions, and we're going to give you a solution that is pretty detailed. So, and in some cases has multiple solutions to problems. So, but please look at it. If you think that you're not ready mathematically to this, you can take the class next year. So I don't want to scare you. As I said, you know, I'm not expecting that you can just sit down and solve everything in half an hour, but I do expect that you've seen some of this or most of it before. So really my perspective is that the class is for people that really want to do machine learning. I mean, either want to do research in machine learning or want to be advanced users of machine learning. So people that are willing to take it seriously, because I think you're going to have to take it seriously to do well in the class. So my perception is, you know, you all start with an A+ in the class, and you can go down from there. You don't have to, but I think people that take it seriously could stay there. Okay, so some policies. It's a large class. We need to have policies. Cheating. So the policy is simple. but really, we're taking it seriously. So, as I said, my assumption is that you all want to be here. You want to understand machine learning. You want to work in machine learning one way or another. So you're going to take it seriously. You'll gain nothing from doing things that are hard to monitor, so please don't. Okay, homework. So collaboration is encouraged. So I do suggest that you talk to other people, work in teams, and so on. If you have problems finding someone to work with, you can also ask us, and we can try to help you. You can use the online mechanisms that we have to get help with it. But at the end, you're going to write your own solution. So the solutions are going to be LaTeX solutions. We're going to give you templates if you've never done it before. At least you learn LaTeX in this class. This is one thing. It's impossible to read handwritten solutions. Some of them are going to be long solutions. This is going to be nice looking at least. And you have to write your own. So even if you talk to other people, at the end you write your own solution. And so I think a lot of learning is done, different kind of learning. A lot of learning is done when you write down the solution. Even though you kind of thought you understood everything, now you write it and explain it, you learn a lot from it. Late policy. So here is the late policy. So we give you 96 hours. That's it. So you can budget it any way you want. We're gonna set deadlines. All the submissions are gonna be online through Compass. We're gonna record when the deadline is when you submitted and count up to 96, and that's it. We're not gonna take things that happened more than 96 hours after it. So my recommendation is don't use it unless you really need it, because maybe something will happen and you need it in the sixth problem set. But basically it's simple, it's easy to monitor. If you really have a huge problem, come and talk to me. But, you know, hopefully 99.5% of you won't have any problems, so that should be good enough. Grading. So, as I said, possibly, more likely than not, it's going to be separate for graduates and undergrads. And again, it's not, I don't want to scare undergrads away. As I said, you know, I had cases where the undergrads were the top students in the class, but as a group, I think they're a little bit less mature than, mathematically mature and programming perhaps, than the grads, and sometimes I can see that, you know, their average is a little bit lower, so we're going to look at it separately. This is the current way we think about grading. Notice that it's a little bit different than what I put on the website. So 40% for the final, 30% for the midterm, 25% for the homework, 5% for classwork. On the website, I put 30% for this, for homework. I didn't include classwork. I actually am not sure how much classwork we can do with 200 people. But you know, we'll try to do some kind of interesting exercises that will take short time at the beginning of some of the classes. We'll see how this works. How many of you are registered for 4 hours? Okay, almost a half. So the way it works is that currently, as far as I know, only graduate students can register for 4 hours. 4 hours means that a quarter of your grade is the project that we're going to do. So it's a big part of your grade, so you should take it seriously. I actually think that it's good to do projects. You learn a lot by doing projects, so I recommend it. I'm going to give more instructions as we go about projects. You can already look at the web. Basically, it's going to be either individuals or pairs projects, no more than that. Ideally, individuals, I think you'll, but I'm fine with pairs if you explain me why. And basically, the idea is that you choose your own topic. You're going to have to write a proposal somewhere before the middle of the semester, short proposal. Instructions are on the web. We're going to talk more about it. I'll approve the proposal, and then you'll do a project that you submit around the end of the semester and hopefully also present. If you're an undergrad and you want to do a project, you can do it. We'll go through the same process. It's only going to help your grade. So for graduate students, if you do a bad project, since it's 25%, it could hurt you. Hopefully it won't. But for undergrads, if you want to do it, it's only going to help you. Okay. Questions? There's one midterm. The approximate date is already on the web. And one final. So the midterm is going to be in class, which means it's going to be 1 hour and 15 minutes. The final, Actually, I want it also be in class. We'll see how this works and how we combine this with the project presentation. Yeah.
So you said all the submissions are going to be on campus?
Yeah.
Okay, so if we're not ready to go to the class, we're going to be able to get
access? Yeah, so the first problem set is only going to be available or due in more than 2 weeks. So I'm hoping that by that time, everyone will be registered. If not, we'll solve the problem as we get there. Other questions? Yeah. Just 1 second. I see that a lot of you have questions, or I can hear that a lot of you have questions. But it's going to be easier if you listen to questions and then ask yours. Yeah.
I see we have pizza and...
Yeah, okay, so let me get there. Other questions about what I... No, it's going to be closed books. Question was if the midterms and the finals are open books or closed books. I said closed books. Yeah. No, only if you're not registered to the class, send me this email. Again, let me show this. This. Only if you're not registered. If you're registered, you're all set. Yeah.
Is that just the word registration?
Yeah, the word registration. I think that last name and first name would be good enough. You know what? Maybe you're right. Maybe it will be easy. Let's... Okay, thanks. So... If you sent me email already, send another one. Yeah. Yeah, okay, I'm getting there. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, so a lot of the communication is going to be through the web page. There is an info page that contains everything I said today and more. Hopefully you visited it. Okay, it doesn't want to go there now, but if you click on it, it should get there. There is a website, there is a schedule page with all the lectures and videos from 2 years ago, and schedule, tentative schedule for the exams and the problem sets. We may massage it a little bit, but, you know, it's relatively good. At least this is our starting point. Won't change radically. So please look at it and please follow the notes because we're going to put notes on the websites. Okay, we have a large team of people. Outside me, we have 40 A's. We named them before. They're going to have office hours. So my office hours is on Tuesday after class. Office hours for the others, I don't think it's final, but it will be on the info page if we change it a little bit. Everything will start next week. I doubt that you'll need the TAs this week. If you do, you can find them again on the info page. You can send emails. We are going to add discussion sessions. So my assumption is that it will be helpful for most of you, if not all of you, to talk with TAs. And many of you are shy and you don't go to office hours. So the solution that I tried already once before and worked beautifully was to have the TA run once a week an hour-long section that will discuss either things that you care about, questions that you have from class, or the problem sets, kind of preparing you for the problem sets. All the problem sets, and I'm going to say it many more times, are of this nature that if you wait until the day before submission, you have no chance. The 96 hours are not going to save you. start when we give it out, and if you have questions, ask the questions. So this is one of the roles. So the TAs are going to be prepared to answer questions about the problem sets or any other questions that you have on the class. So we're going to have 1 hour every day in the evening. We may change it a little bit, but it's going to be all after 5, 4 days a week. I split you to groups. Currently, this is about uniform. Again, I may change it a little bit. It's going to start only next week, so I'm going to look at the list and see, but A to F, G to L, M to S, T to Z is by last name. Last name that starts with these characters belong to this section. Hopefully you can make it, and it's pretty uniform. If you cannot make it, let us know. I just want to keep it pretty uniform. Okay, so let us know, send email. We're not religious about it, but I want to be pretty uniform. So that answered the question about the sections. Any other question about the section? Last name. Yeah. No, I'm not allowed by law to have these sections mandatory. So you don't have to go. I think you'll gain from it. You don't have to go. Yeah.
If we can't make it to ours, can we just go to one of the others?
Yeah, but I'd like you to let me know. If you cannot make it to yours, it's okay to go to another. I want to know, because I want to keep it relatively uniform, so I want to know what's happening. Again, we're not religious about that too, but I don't want, you know, I'm going to cancel the 5 to 6 on day X if I see that many people cannot make it, and we'll move it to another time that people can make it. So, other questions? Okay, so we are online. There's a website. Everything is going to be on the website. There's going to be Piazza for interaction. You can ask questions. You can answer questions. Don't give the solutions to the problem set, but, you know, you can talk about it. We are going to talk about it also. We're going to go on it. I know that at least 40 students were already on it this morning, so many of you found it. Please enroll. Compass is another thing that we're going to use. All the submissions are going to be through Compass. And the grades and statistics on the grades are going to be available there. Okay. Okay, just a second. It's as I said, it's a loud class. We have 5 more minutes. Let me finish with the lectures are all available on the website. So if you go to the website, figure out how to navigate, it's going to be easy for you to find all the lectures. It's under a page that is called lectures, and it's going to be there. Okay, so we did not talk about the badges game. I don't want answers now, because we're going to start with it next time. Who knows the answer to the question? Okay, excellent. So please look at it. If you don't have the game printed, it's on the web page. You'll find it in one of the handouts, handouts 2. Handouts 1 was supposed to be the info page, but I decided not to print it. And we're going to start talking about it next time. This is really, what I want you to think about is not only what the solution is, but also how would you write a program that will behave well under some definition of behaving well. You'll have to think about what could be a definition of behaving well too, but how would you write a program that does that? Not so easy. You will do it as we go. It will be easy, hopefully, in a couple of months. But now, some of you may know how to do it. Some of you may think they know how to do it, and many of you don't. So it will be interesting. Final questions? Yeah? Okay, that's exactly what I meant when I say you will have to define what I mean by behave well. And you already see that there are multiple options here. So if you didn't get it, okay, think about it yourself. But there are multiple options. So, good question. Others? Okay, so see you on Thursday.